The resolution being debated this evening is atheism poisons everything. Everything. Arguing the affirmative of the resolution is Dr. David Berlinski, a scientist, professor of mathematics, and author of many books, most notably The Devil's Delusion, Atheism and Its Scientific Pretensions. Arguing the negative of the resolution is Christopher Hitchens, a journalist, cultural critic, and best-selling author. And most recently, he is the author of the memoir, Hitch 22. We will now begin our debate. And Dr. David Berlinski, please open for us.
Thank you all very much for being here. I would like to thank Larry Taunton and the Fixed Point Foundation for their outstanding hospitality. And to Christopher Hitchens, Lanceman, my pleasure at being allowed to bask in the radiance of his reputation and L'chaim. The proposition before us is atheism poisons everything. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm perfectly aware, and you should be too, that that proposition is fully compatible with the proposition that religion poisons something. Were Christopher Hitchens and Richard Dawkins tomorrow to announce that they were prepared to invade hell in order to roust a variety of pederastic priests, I would wish them well, although for reasons of personal inconvenience, I could not join them. In some respects, as Dr. Johnson once said, the proposition that atheism poisons everything hardly requires a defense. The inquiry is not needed, he said. The last date at which atheism was a possibility in social thought was also the last date in which it was a plausibility in social thought. I ask you to cast your mind back, oh, around 1790, 1791 in France, Paris, in front of the Cathedral of Notre Dame. And standing there, somewhat elaborated by my historical imagination, is Robespierre, reed thin, narrow, green-eyed, fanatical, rabid as a bat, and Danton, large, boisterous, remarkably eloquent. And they're watching, or they're looking at Notre Dame, and one guy says to the other, "What should we do with this pile of Gothic junk?" And the answer is, "Let's rename it." Good idea. What should we call it? Each man was hoping they would call it after themselves, but that was not to be. And Robespierre came up with a wonderful idea. We'll call it the Temple of Reason. Good thinking, his companion said. The Temple of Reason, that works splendidly. It means nothing, but it works splendidly. We might as well have called it the Temple of Evidence, Temple of Rationality. What should we do next, was the question. And the inevitable answer, the answer known from historical circumstances, well, let's go out and kill a whole lot of people. And that's exactly what they did. Once they had renamed Notre Dame the Temple of Reason, it was relatively easy to go out and kill 50,000 innocent men, women, and children. That, I submit to you, is the nature of the proposition we are discussing. 1851, 60 or 70 years later, an age of remarkable progress, enlightenment, wonderful sense of dawning material possibility, Matthew Arnold, in a poem entitled Dover Beach, reflected on the decline of religious faith in Europe, the melancholy, long withdrawing raw. He didn't see anything particularly optimistic in that withdrawal. And he could think to say to himself and to his readers, only this, ah, my beloved, let us be true to one another. My beloved, true to one another. For the world which lies about us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath neither really joy, nor light, nor love, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help for pain, and we are caught as on a darkling plain, swept by confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night. This is a prophetic declaration from the heart of the progressive enlightened 19th century. In 1914, surveying the carnage that was to come, the Foreign Secretary of Great Britain said, again prophetically, "The lights are going out all over Europe." The lights, what a strange word. We shall not see them lit again in our time. Ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that the 20th century was a record in Germany, in Russia, in China, in Cambodia, and elsewhere, not only of remarkable stupidity, brutality, and violence, but of unparalleled brutality, stupidity, and violence. And each of the regimes behind this remarkable decay of civilization had two features in common, two characteristics we should bear in mind. In the first place, the men guiding these regimes and their entourage did not believe for a moment there was any power higher than their own. And they acted on that assumption. And in the second place, in the mass murders they conducted, they were aided and supported by any number of crackpot scientific disciplines. That makes for a characteristic combination. In the case of the Nazis, the scientific disciplines were derived from biology, and especially from Darwinian biology. In 1937, having murdered 70,000 handicapped men, women, and children, the Nazis released a film, and on the background of the film, the narrator says, in terms of solemn incomprehension, "My goodness, we have sinned against the law of natural selection." The law of natural selection. What could that mean? We have sinned against the law of natural selection. The communists, of course, had an equally crackpot theory that they derived from Marxian economics, the two crackpotteries joining in one deeply repugnant stream. As all of you know, atheism today is not simply the private doctrine of a handful of individuals. It's become a social movement. And as a social movement, it has been advanced chiefly by the scientific community, certainly in the United States, but to a large extent in Europe too. Some of this is adventitious. A few popular writers, such as Richard Dawkins, discovered that by writing books indicating that science has shown that God does not exist, well, they could make a fortune. I'm very sorry I wasn't there to join them. I didn't think of it at the time. I'm quite sure that someone now is writing a book, "How Margarine Science Shows That God Does Not Exist." But the inevitable consequences of this degree of atheism within the scientific community has involved a deformation of scientific thought, quite striking in its character and its extent. After all, the sciences, if we restrict our attention to the serious sciences, and those may be found in mathematics or in mathematical physics in no other place, then we must recognize that the serious sciences have nothing to say about the existence of God, either in their premises or in their conclusion. What a remarkable fact. People are writing books how physics shows that God does not exist, but physics has nothing to say about the existence of God. The aching questions that trouble the human imagination, about which the sciences, when seriously considered, are resolutely silent, these remain just where they were. And the religious tradition, especially the Judeo-Christian religious tradition, has offered a coherent body of belief and doctrine by which they can be explained. Do we understand why the universe arose 14 million? No, we don't. Do we understand why it's there at all? No, we have no idea. Do we understand how life emerged on Earth? Not a prayer right now. Do we understand the complexity of life? We can't even begin to describe a living creature in anything resembling precise terms. Recent article in Science Digest, cell division requires 4,000 coordinated proteins acting together. What a remarkable statement. What a wealth of information we possess about biology. What an abundant lack of understanding we have about living systems. Do we understand why the laws of nature are true? No, we have no idea. Do we understand the miracle of analytic continuation in physics when certain kinds of functions can be pushed forward into the future contrary to all experience? Do we understand why the universe remains stable from moment to moment? The medievals pondered this question, ladies and gentlemen, and they came to the conclusion, and I quote a medieval theologian, that God is everywhere conserving the world. What a remarkable declaration. Can we do without it? Can we do without it? Do we have an explanation for the continuity and stability of the universe? There is one paper that I know in the literature by Freeman Dyson that addresses the stability of matter. But beyond that, everything is enigmatic. How can we propose seriously and solemnly to rule out of court in advance a hypothesis that not only answers to the human heart in many respects, but that answers to genuine intellectual needs in other respects? When one sees the American scientific community like a herd of wildebeests trotting across a fruited plain, it's very reasonable to ask, are they going someplace or are they fleeing from someplace? And I think the overwhelmingly obvious answer is they are fleeing. They are fleeing from an idea that they reject for a variety of reasons. Not only is the inquiry about atheism not necessary in terms of the history of social thought, it's not necessary in terms of the outlines of scientific thought, but there is a last question to be addressed, perhaps the most important for you and me. The cosmologist Joel Primack asked an interesting question. He asked, what compels the electron to follow the laws of nature? Good question, I don't know. But Heinrich Himmler, who had presided over the destruction of churches and synagogues throughout Europe and was the mastermind behind the extermination of the Jewish people, asked a very similar question in 1944. When confronted with the onerous treaty obligations the German state had adopted with respect to its own satraps, he asked insouciantly but pregnantly, after all, what compels us to keep our promises? Moral relativism is very often derided as an unhappy consequence of atheism. I don't think moral relativism is a particularly deep issue, but I do think the issue of what compels us to keep our promises is very relevant. I have in front of me rather a remarkable button. If you should press it, yours would be untold riches and whatever else you desire. The only consequence to pressing it beyond your happiness is the death of an anonymous Chinese peasant. Who among us would you trust with this button? Sit still, Christopher. Thank you. Christopher Hitchens.
Can you give me 3 minutes, not 30 seconds? Can you give me 3 minutes, not 30 seconds? Thank you, Professor Berlinski. Thank you, Larry, for the very generous introduction. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming. At short notice, I can only hope to match the Parisian urbanity of my rival in knowledge of French ecclesiastical architecture and its cosmic implications, and in modern, and in the ready access to modern 20th century poetry. Well, let's take, instead of Notre Dame and the famous story of its deconsecration by Danton and Robespierre, the erection of the other most prominent église of Paris, the one that you see on your way in from the airport, the grand wedding cake style erection of Sacré-Cœur, the Sacred Heart, built on top of the commanding heights of Montmartre. Built why? Built to celebrate the massacre of Parisian workers and intellectuals after the Paris Commune of 1871 had tried to save the honor of a humiliated France that had thrown itself officially and was thrashing at the feet of Bismarck and his Prussian invaders. many, many more people were killed in that massacre and that terrible reprisal than were killed in the whole of the terror. But it was, and it wasn't enough that that was the case, but a whole church had to be consecrated by the French religious and clerical establishment and their political allies to celebrate the massacre of their fellow countrymen. Does this prove that religion poisons everything? By no means does it do so. Does it help to curtain raise and to understand the terrible century which Professor Berlinski and I have both studied? Yes, to a degree it does. This French right wing, clerical right wing, goes on to the terrible arraignment and frame-up of Captain Alfred Dreyfus, possibly the most serious miscarriage of justice in most thoroughgoingly justified and advanced by a political establishment in modern European history. This and the sides taken in it determine who will be who in the terrible war of 1914, which Dermot McCullough, admired by Larry Taunton, among others, as a historian of Christianity, and very much venerated by me in his magnificent history, new history of the first 2,000 years of Christianity, describes as a theocratic war. He says the Christendom, as we used to understand it, as our fathers and grandfathers used to understand it, ends in 1914, when every country in Europe goes to war in the name of its own God or church. King George VI is the King Emperor and the head of the Church of England. The Tsar of Russia is the head of the Russian Orthodox Church, is considered not to be a god, but a little more than a human being. You know the rest of it. It's the first time that Gott mit uns is put on the belt buckles, but not the last time, of the German army. And this is the end of Christendom and the curtain raiser to fascism. Without that terrible war of Christendom, it's impossible that the totalitarian movements that became such a threat to civilization could have arisen in the first place. And just to stay with France, it is the Vichy collaborationist regime, the rounder-up of France's Jews, the massacre agent in the French colonies, the collaborator with the Third Reich, that strikes from the French coinage the noble words liberty, liberté, égalité, fraternité, and replaces them with the Catholic slogan, famille, patrie, travail. And under this, France fell to the lowest point of its history. So I would beware, sir, of deriving your argument about atheism from the coincidences of French ecclesiastical design. But I'm with you on the larger point that you made, and I'll also try and illustrate it from the work, actually, of a great Anglo-Catholic, Anglo-American poet, Thomas Stearns Eliot, who in his choruses from the Rock asks the question, where is the knowledge we have lost in information? This is a question that has to preoccupy us all. When I am told, and I suppose in one way you could accuse me of taking it on faith, because I couldn't prove it for myself, and having had it demonstrated to me, I probably couldn't repeat the demonstration. But having been told by Stephen Hawking and Lawrence Krauss and all of the leaders in the field of physics that we now estimate a total of 400 billion galaxies. That's not universes or solar systems, 400 billion galaxies. And asked to decide the question, with one sun every second since the Big Bang, or one star, we only call our own star the sun in an apotropaic, propitiating way that comes from our terrorized ancestors. A star that size goes out every second. So that's quite a lot while I'm talking. And has been blowing up and going out ever since the first moment of the Big Bang. This is more than we can handle. We cannot say we know about this. It can be argued that all that was indeed set in motion with the intention of producing, on a very small planet, in a very small solar system, in a tiny neglected suburb of a relatively unimportant galaxy, a race of beings, primate, but capable of language and reason, who believe that if they make the right propitiations, they will live forever. You could say that all that gigantic explosion and destruction was designed with that in mind, but I wouldn't be able to take your word for it. And it seems to me that the burden is not on me. I don't have to prove that kind of thing. I don't make the equivalent claim that the religious person has to make. The religious person doesn't have to just say, of course God wanted it that way, and that's the way it is. because a design of that kind doesn't just imply a designer, it implicates a designer. It means if there is such a designer, he's fantastically destructive and wasteful, as he is in microcosm. 99.8% of all species ever on this earth have already become extinct. This is a pitiless, wasteful, capricious designer. I can't prove that that isn't the way he wanted it to be, but I can say that there's an implication for the designer. But again, it's not me who's saying that if you believe in it, you have the means of grace and the hope of glory and the possibility of redemption and vicarious salvation and forgiveness of sins through human sacrifice and eternal life. We can't attempt and don't try anything like that. So the agnostic or the deist is not arbitrating between equal kinds of certainty. Those who are certain in the face of all this uncertainty and unknowability, the strongest ground of agreement between me and David, are bound to say, if they're arbitrating it properly, the first people to leave the island are the ones who say they already know enough, that they know why this is happening, that they know the mind of God. Those who claim the certainty are out of the argument. The argument then goes on between deists, agnostics, and atheists. How can we make sense of what we know? And how can we, in doing so, be true to the great principle adumbrated by Socrates, which is this: you must educate yourself by striving constantly, excuse me, as hard as you can to get to the point of understanding your own ignorance. Only then can you claim to have any acquaintance with knowledge at all. That's the appropriate and due modesty that the founder of our school of thought brought to the question. And there's no proof that Socrates ever existed. I tend to think, from the eyewitness accounts and secondhand ones, that he did. It would be quite hard to confect such a personality, but it doesn't matter to me whether he existed or not. We have the method. He taught us how to think. If I was to tell Larry, after our drive down through Shenandoah yesterday and our joint reading of the first passages of the Gospel of St. John, that the Jesus who is so real to him is in fact, or could be proved to be, only a fictitious person, a mythical individual, it would have to ruin Comrade Taunton's day. Not just his day, his life. It would extinguish his hope. Is there not something slightly fanatical in placing such large claims, remember the size of the claims I'm talking about,
3 minutes,
on such a slender and narrow basis? Now we'll get to the Nazis in my rebuttal, if that's all right. That won't take frightfully long, and to the totalitarians. And we'll have to do, can we be moral without believing fantastic things? That won't take too long either. And we can do a number of other things too that I have so far left unaddressed, but believe me, not forgotten. But I just wanted to see if I could introduce, just for once, a new element into this argument. You must, when you next go to Washington, go to the newest museum in the United States. It's the newly opened Hall of Human Origins in the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History. It's, by the way, paid for by Mr. Koch, the former libertarian candidate for president and founder and paymaster of the Tea Party movement. So I invite you to join me once again in saying, in some way, this really is a great country. Here is the greatest gallery giving the proper account of evolution and our true origins that has ever been erected in any country. The bit that has fascinated me and taken me back to it again and again is this. Until 17,000 years ago only in one case, and not many more years than that in others, there were at least three other hominid or human species. Primates like us with large brain pans, language capacity, in the case of the Neanderthals very significantly, decorated graves, which suggests, if it doesn't insist upon the idea of a ritual and a religion. They have genes in common with us. They are of our species. And they've left important traces. They weren't very well understood, or in some cases known at all, the case of the Flores Islanders of the Indonesian archipelago, only until very recently. But there they always were. They were our brothers and our sisters and our kin. And they had all these yearnings and hopes and terrors and fears. And they're not in Genesis. and they've had no one to visit their graves or do them honor until very recently, and as a result of scientific innovation and curiosity. And whatever gods they had abandoned them. And so I just think it's worth brooding, since we talk about ourselves as the objects of a tremendous cosmic and biological process that was set in motion, supervised, and if it's to be believed, designed, intended. I just think we should take a moment of silence and think of our fellow humans, our fellow creatures, our fellow extinct, already extinct members of our species, to whom we might spare a little thought before we go on. I'm in your debt, and I'll be back. Thanks.
We now move to rebuttals. 6 minutes, Dr. Berlinski.
Thank you very much. There's a disturbing area of agreement that I sense between Mr. Hitchens and myself, which I will do my best to minimize. Please remember, ladies and gentlemen, that when it comes to the wickedness of religion, I have ceded the point. It's no longer argumentative. I would remind you, however, of a remark Dr. Johnson made. He made it about original sin, and I paraphrased him. He said, the inquiry is not necessary, for all the laws of heaven and earth are unable to prevent men from their crimes. Now, Mr. Hitchens is very much in the position of someone watching a cripple walking painfully with two crutches, moving arduously, and saying to himself and saying to you, I've got a great idea, kick one of the crutches away. Everything will be so much better. That seems to me a weak argument. A weak argument, not an impossible argument. I would welcome the defense of the argument. But it is no rebuttal to my position that atheism poisons everything, that religion poisons something. There are plenty of poisons in the world. We don't lack an abundance. Second point I would like to mention is this strange enchantment with the views of, say, Lawrence Krauss or Stephen Hawking. You know, Stephen Hawking just published a book, and I don't know whether any of you have yet seen it. It is, again, a book explaining how everything began, why it's there, why we shouldn't worry about God, and a multitude of other subjects. He published it in collaboration with a friend of mine, Leonard Mlodinow, and of course, the lines are very deep in the bookstores. And to paraphrase the claim that he now makes, having given up A through N, he now champions something called M theory. The claim that he now makes is the universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M theory. The universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M theory. I don't deny what Stephen Hawking has said. I do not endorse it. I haven't read the book, although I've read his other books. I respect Hawking as a reputable physicist who did his great work 30 or 40 years ago. But I can tell you this, what is lamentably lacking in every one of these discussions is that coruscating spirit of skepticism, which a Christopher Hitchens or a Richard Dawkins or a Vic Stengel will bring to religious claims, and that lapses absurdly when it comes to scientific claims. Surely we should have the sophistication to wonder at any asseveration of the form that the universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M theory, a theory that no one can understand, whose mathematical formalism hasn't been completed, and which has never once been tested in any laboratory on the face of the earth. Third and final point of rebuttal, the fact that the Earth, our home, is a small part of the physical universe does not mean it is not the center of the universe. That is a non sequitur. After all, no one would argue, least of all Mr. Hitchens, that the doctrine that home is where the heart lies is rendered false by distance. We should be very careful about making these claims. I agree, the universe is very big, lots of galaxies, amazing things. And there is certainly some point of continuity between human beings and the animals that went before. But as for the central religious claim that this particular place is blessed and important, that's quite different. No doctrine about physical size rebuts it. Thanks very much.
How much? Yeah, I want them all. Yeah, I want. I swore to answer Professor Berlinski's 2 points about totalitarianism and atheism. Well, his 1 point, and I had one to make. Perhaps I'll make it in preface. Atheism by itself is, of course, not a moral position or a political one of any kind. It simply is the refusal to believe in a supernatural dimension or a supernatural supervisor or dictator. And it's the maintenance of the view that, though that cannot be disproved, no good evidence has ever been adduced for it or any good argument put forward for it. But that's where it ends. You can be an atheist and a nihilist. You can be an atheist and a sadist. You can be an atheist and say, as is said in Dostoevsky's famous passage of Brothers Karamazov, without God, anything is possible, anything is doable, is thinkable. Of course, that's open, I would say, immediately to the objection that anyone who says they have God on their side also awards themselves, and you can see it happening by opening the newspaper, the right to commit any crime, however ghastly, that there's no escape from the existence of certain psychopathic human beings who either for want of supervision or by invoking the idea that they are the agents of a divine supervisor will do anything at all. But that gets us no further forward. You can be an atheist and a fascist. Most fascists were actually Christian. You can be an atheist and a communist. Most, but not all, communists were unbelievers by definition. You can be an atheist and perfectly indifferent to your fellow creatures. But there is a humanism within atheism. It starts, I think, with Lucretius, who put the atomic theory of Democritus and Epicurus into a wonderful poem that effectively suggested not that people were using religion as a crutch, as you so in such a domesticated and furry way put it, but that instead, on a very hot day, they were putting on a huge, heavy overcoat and dragging a ball and chain. Oh dear, my crops have failed. I didn't make enough sacrifices. Oh God, I've had a filthy thought. Now I'm going to hell. Or my children are, because I didn't baptize them. Man forged manacles of terror and ignorance and stupidity, the emancipation of which, of our species, has been millimetrically slow, but in which materialist and atheist thinkers have played a great part. Without Lucretius, you only have to read Galileo's work. He's inspired by the work of Lucretius. He considers himself to be very lucky to possess one of the very few copies of Lucretius' work that was not destroyed in the Christian centuries, in the hope of putting an end to such terrible, unwise speculations as that, as so much of Galileo's work was either destroyed or censored. On the slow, the thread is passed on. It's picked up by the greatest Jew who ever breathed, Baruch Spinoza, changing his name later after his excommunication from the synagogue to Benedict, who said, if there's a God, he's pantheistic, he's in nature, there's no personal God, prayers are not answered, divine interventions do not occur, the consolations of philosophy must be resorted to. From him and people like him, we get the Enlightenment, in which not only Danton and Robespierre, ladies and gentlemen, have their share, but Thomas Paine and Thomas Jefferson and the founders of this great republic and the Philadelphia Enlightenment. This is not a tradition of which anyone on my side need be ashamed. And of course, not all of it is atheist, some of it is deist, but it becomes more atheist as Darwin and Einstein and others approach us with their mind-boggling, almost one wants to say mind-altering findings. And you perhaps will say it's a coincidence that Einstein is expelled by the Third Reich, along with anyone else who understood anything about biology or physics, as practitioners of Jewish science. I'm sorry, the area of agreement has just contracted, sir. For you to say of Nazism that it was the implementation of the work of Charles Darwin is a filthy slander, undeserving of you, and an insult to this audience. Darwin's thought was not taught in Germany. Darwinism was derided in Germany, along with every other form of unbelief. All the great modern atheist thinkers, Darwin, Einstein, and Freud, were alike despised by the National Socialist regime. And there is, it said, I believe it to be true, a misprint in one German edition of The Origin of Species from which the full statement that evolution requires the survival of the fittest is taken, a statement never made by Darwin, who, as anyone knows, says that adaptability is what is likeliest to give survival or luck or advantage, we'd better say, in the struggle. Now, just to take the most notorious of the 20th century totalitarianisms, the most finished example, the most perfected one, the most ruthless and refined one, that of National Socialism, the one that fortunately allowed the escape of all these great atheist thinkers and many others to the United States, country of separation of church and state that gave them welcome. If it's an atheistic regime, then how come that in the first chapter of Mein Kampf, Hitler says he's doing God's work and executing God's will in destroying the Jewish people? How come the Führer oath that every officer of the party and the army had to take, making Hitler into a minor god, begins, "I swear in the name of Almighty God, my loyalty to the Führer"? How come that on the belt buckle of every Nazi soldier it says, "Gott mit uns," God on our side? How come that the first treaty made by the National Socialist dictatorship, the very first, is with the Vatican, exchanging political control of Germany for Catholic control of German education? How come that the church is celebrated the birthday of the Führer every day, every year, I mean, on that day, until democracy put an end to this filthy, quasi-religious, superstitious, barbarous, reactionary system? Again, this is not a difference of emphasis between us, to suggest that there's something fascistic about me and my beliefs is something I won't hear said, and you shouldn't believe. Thank you.
Dr. Berlinski, your recap, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you. I've endeavored to assert the following proposition. First, the general proposition that atheism poisons everything. And second, the ancillary proposition that for sure religion poisons something. These propositions are not in conflict. And at the beginning of the discussion, I said they weren't in conflict. So asseverations to the contrary introduce into this discussion neither interesting evidence nor a valid argument. In terms of the social history of atheism, it seems to me, when I began this debate, and still seems to me now, overwhelmingly clear that while Nazism in Germany, communism in Russia, communism in China even, communism in Cambodia certainly had religious elements. Who would deny that? Why is that an interesting claim? The governing apparatus of ideology, no matter what Hitler had to say about his devotion to a warrior like Christ, involved the proposition among those who ruled these states and their entourage that no power was greater than their own. They acted on that proposition. They were restrained by nothing. And we saw the consequences. Now you may say, and perhaps say truly, that in their heart of hearts some Catholics adopted the rituals of the SS and took communion after an especially arduous day murdering innocent women in the fields of Poland. Could be true, I don't deny it. But what we must ask ourselves, if this is to be an intellectually serious discussion, is not whether there were infiltrations of religious thought in the worst tyrannies of mankind. Of course there were. That goes without saying. But whether something fundamental had changed in the diapason of thought that made these atrocities possible. And I say, yes, there was. I've argued as well that atheism as a position has a deforming influence on science, and I've given you my reasons. Finally, I have argued that atheism, insofar as it removes from the human context a brute sense of obligation based on fear, removes from the moral calculus profound and powerful reason not to do evil. I think there's no escaping this. It's unpleasant. I don't particularly like it. And to be perfectly honest, I haven't lived my life that way, but I recognize it as a fact. and I think we all must. With that said, I thank you for listening.
Well, I think perhaps I can help close the gap a little, the gap that Professor Berlinski complains of in my closing remarks. I came across a stray comment by George Orwell, of whom I'm a great admirer, in a little-known essay recently, in which he said, at root, all totalitarianism must be theocratic. And I thought of my most admired author, that's rather stretching it. This, it's certainly possible to admire totalitarianism, to identify totalitarianisms that are not explicitly religious. He went on to clarify it a bit. He said, the reason I say it's theocratic is this. In all such dictatorships, there must be certain unchallengeable assumptions, some things that are beyond discussion, that are not available for debate, that must be taken as statements of faith. In other words, in Italy, for example, under fascism, il duce ha sempre ragione, the leader is always right. The cult of the Führer, the view that Stalin could bring two or three crops a year and was the great protector of the people, the worship of Mao, to take the other great element of the Axis powers, Japan, the emperor was actually a god, couldn't have anything more theocratic than that, though he had secular appearance as well. Now, if you think of totalitarianism in that way, and if you think of that as the greatest poison, since I'm accused not of mentioning poison enough or stressing it enough, then you'll see that the charge that is essentially theocratic is true because it depends upon unchallengeable statements, dogma, and faith. I don't know if anyone wants to name to me, or whether David will take up the challenge, a statement of atheism that is a statement purely of faith, independent of evidence, requiring no reasoning, and above all, punishable if challenged. I don't believe you can come up with anything of the sort. To the contrary, the little faction with which I'm honored to be identified as a junior member is adamant for doubt, is resolved to be skeptical, is certain only of the principle of uncertainty, and says that what we have yet to know is enormously greater than anything we have discovered or known so far, and that and only that is the test of education, of intellectual integrity, of honesty and inquiry, and, yes, let's hope for it, the emancipation of humans from man-made, and I stress man-made, delusions, including hopeful ones, including false consolation. And thus again, and I'll close by repeating myself, I've done worse. It is only those who claim to know things like the mind of God and the origins and destination and intention of the universe. It is they and only they who owe the explanation, and so far this evening haven't cared to furnish it. Thank you.
We now move to the question and answer form of time of this evening, and we begin with Christopher Hitchens. And Christopher, your first question, what are the weaknesses of Pascal's wager?
Well, sometimes known, by the way, as Pascal's gambit, which is, I think, a suggestive coinage. For those of you who don't know, or who might be watching, of whom this is new, I'll just state it, I hope not too crudely. Blaise Pascal, who was one of the founders of probability theory and a great mathematician and a great Catholic apologist of the 17th century, phrased it like this. He was addressing the people he called those who are so made that they cannot believe. That's me, for example. And he said, well, if you can't believe, think of it like this. If you bet that making the right adjustments to your relationship with God will save you in the future, in a future state, and you're right, you win a lot. If you're wrong, what have you lost? What have you got to lose? Now, the reason why I say wager and gambit are appropriate for this is it's obviously a very hucksterish claim, or offer, I mean to say. It's pretty cheap and pretty vulgar, and I would say especially so when offered to people who are dying or ill or frightened or in extremis. I think it's distinctly nasty and sharp practice to try it on them, but I think it's pretty sharp and nasty at any time. And you'll notice that it postulates, and here are its other weaknesses, two things. One, a very cynical and gullible God who will, if I say to him, tell you what, I'll give up the convictions of a lifetime, fling myself at your feet, pretend I believe, hope you're impressed, would say, yeah, that's good, that's progress. In other words, you get no reward for intellectual consistency, courage, honesty, anything of that sort. And of course, as with all these human-made ideas of divine tribunals, no lawyers will represent you, no appeal, and no opportunity to produce any evidence. I pass over that lightly and say, what does it ask also of the wager? It asks for someone to be a credulous, cringing, unprincipled serf who says, sure, what are principles for if not to be sold in the hope of a future boon? Well, those are the largest, I think, shortcomings of Pascalian, and by implication, all other religious reasoning about the death judgment and the other last things. Thank you.
Dr. Berlinski, what are the strengths of Pascal's wager?
Very good.
Hola. That from a distinguished mathematician.
Still. Would you,
Christopher Hitchens, would you agree with the following statement made by Sam Harris? And I quote, some propositions are so dangerous that it may even be ethical to kill people for believing them.
You would be idle in dismissing it at the first reading, and obviously Sam has put it at its most blunt. But I'll give you a very practical example of a current theocratic dictatorship. We've all wondered, at least everyone of my age has since they were small, what will happen the day that a really nasty guy gets hold of a really bad weapon? That was how I thought about it when I was 7. I would now say, what happens when a messianic regime lays hold of an apocalyptic weapon? Well, we're about to find out. And the people who have plagiarized the ingredients of this weapon, stolen it from piracy on the high seas, broken every international law, every agreement, every treaty they've ever signed with the UN, the Atomic Energy Authority, EU, and so forth, are governed by the totalitarian theory called the velayat du faqih, the guardianship of the jurist, the supreme leader. Notice that again, another supreme leader, another divinely inspired dictator whose word cannot be challenged and who wants to bring on the end of days. It's not the least of my dislikes of religion that it has openly or covertly an expressed wish, a clear one, for the end of the world. It doesn't like this world, wants it to finish. People who are in the process of acquiring the secular weaponry with which to bring about genocide deserve, I think, to have their ideology treated as toxic and its characters as dangerous vermin and as, like pirates and terrorists, people who it is lawful to destroy. Yes, so to that extent, I'm with Sam, sure.
Dr. Berlinski, you're not a Christian, and indeed you're not religious, as I understand it. Why do you argue for the influence of Christianity or a Judeo-Christian influence in society?
I presume you're not asking that in the hopes of a personal declaration. I mean, I argue for a great many things, and my personal involvement in topics for debate is variable. This particular question strikes me as more important and more demanding of a personal involvement than most. I think the issue is tremendously significant. I think if we're honest about the times in which we live, it's quite right what Matthew Arnold suggested. The sea of faith has been receding under the power of a variety of forces. And the results have, in a certain way, been catastrophic for the human race. I should not say that a secular Jew has a remarkable degree of authority when it comes to discussing these events. After all, I have lived my own life under the impress of the maxim to have a good time all the time. But on the other hand, it doesn't hurt to hear these words from someone such as myself, because at least you are hearing these words for someone with no conceivable bias in their favor. I count myself as an objective observer of the circumstances. So perhaps that's the only reasonable answer I can give. These are important questions. They've had horrific consequences in human history. They continue to have horrific consequences, especially in intellectual history. And in response to why should it be that a secular Jew opens his mouth on questions pertaining to the Christian religion?
10 seconds.
It's a big tent. I'm presuming I will be welcome. Thank you.
Christopher Hitchens, what specific teachings of Jesus do you believe to be evil or poisonous?
The concept of vicarious redemption is the most repulsive, I think, and the most central. I mean, I could pick a lot of peripheral utterances of the Nazarene, or alleged utterances of the Nazarene, but the inescapable one, the one that none of his followers troubles to deny, that he is the idea that by throwing your sins onto somebody else, onto a scapegoat, you can have them annealed, polished. That is a disgusting and immoral doctrine. If I care for you enough, I can pay your debt, even if you incurred it out of your own stupid irresponsibility. I could, if I wished, and it's been done, offer to take your place in prison, though not many people will allow the exchange, or if you were a hostage. I could do that if I loved you enough, and there are examples of people willing to put themselves forward as the substitute for someone's execution. I suppose Sidney Carton in A Tale of Two Cities is the best-known folkloric one, but you cannot relieve people of their responsibility. And it's immoral to offer to do so, and it would be disgusting if it could be done. So the moral rot of Christianity is, I think, exposed in its central doctrine of vicarious forgiveness. It's an abdication of moral responsibility. I think the idea of taking no thought for the morrow, of the instructions are, abandon your family. If you don't, you are one who hates me. Give up investment, thrift, any thought of a future, children, architecture, anything of the sort. Forget all that and follow me is moral only on one condition, and it's the condition I referred to before, that the world is about to come to an end, and that only those who stick by me, a familiar trope from deluded prophets throughout the ages, are going to get out of it. Again, I would say a multiply wicked thing to be saying and offer to be making. We would be so much better off without this cult. We would think so much more clearly about the real moral questions that confront us. Thank you.
Given this choice and no other, would you prefer a secular or an Islamic Europe?
What, my dear sir, makes you think it's a choice right now? Large portions of Europe are already Islamic. I mean, how would I adjust the European continent? I have no opinion. Why should I judge the European continent? As far as I can tell, having conducted a relationship with the Arab community for more than 11 years, I have no objections to Muslims in Europe.
David, do you mind if I breach convention to one degree and
cigarettes?
Say why I think you could have answered that better?
Sure.
I mean, because it implied in your view that atheism poisons everything, is it not, and I think this was the intention of the question anyway, that I'd be better off as a Wahhabi than I would as an atheist? Now, what Larry, I think, was trying to ask you is, do you seriously maintain any such thing?
You mean with respect to Europe?
would Europe be better religious but Islamic or without God? Is, that, I think, the question, is it not? And I miniaturized it for myself. I invite you to take another run at it. I strongly advise it, and you can have it out of my time.
This is a forced choice. Which would you prefer? An Islamic Europe? Would you like to live in an Islamic Europe, or would you do live in Europe, or would you prefer to live in a secular?
The trouble is the question has no provocative urgency for me. It has none whatsoever. I mean, it's like asking which I would prefer to be dressed in gold or in silver. It's not a living issue.
Hey. Christopher, do you believe that all, and this is, by the way, is your last question, so at the end, take an extra minute or so to summarize your arguments and to make a final statement. Do you believe that all religions are equally poisonous?
My beloved younger daughter today became a senior at Sidwell Friends School in Washington. So at least I know that she's under serious police guard during the day. And as its name implies, this is a Quaker foundation where if she hasn't understood the story of Frederick Douglass and Elizabeth Cady Stanton and many other people by now, it's not for dint, want of, excuse me, not for want of trying. And so would I not be fatuous or demagogic if I said that Quakerism to me is exactly the same as Wahhabism or the Twelver Shiite theory of the Velayat-e Faqih, the Khomeini theory? Of course not. But religions, different ones, do take their turn at bat, I think, to show how dangerous the religious proposition is. Quakers, for example, expelled from their ranks those who supported the American Revolution because they thought that they'd taken an oath of loyalty and that it transcended all other principles, and there had to be another Quaker meeting set up in Philadelphia, chucked out. Betsy, an Episcopalian, and so on. The more you look at some of these supposedly innocuous sects, you realize they're only innocuous because they've become so by having their fangs drawn by civil society over the years. When Jefferson says to the Baptists of Danbury, Connecticut, well, don't worry, you live in a country that has a wall of separation between church and state, and it will ever be thus. Who can tell me? Actually, I've got a better chance in Birmingham of getting someone. Who were the Baptists of Danbury, Connecticut afraid of? Oh, come on. Oh, come on, the Congregationalists. One in Alabama. The Congregationalists of Danbury, Connecticut thought that Baptists shouldn't be citizens. So, I've only got a minute. So, just as I would have said 50 years ago, the Catholic Church is by far the most dangerous because of its open, soggy, disgusting, rotten alliance with fascism, which it didn't get over till well after the Second World War. Obviously now Islam, which had been going through a long period of latency, is by far the most dangerous religion. But yes, they all make the same mistake. They all take the only real faculty we have that distinguishes us from other primates and from other animals, the faculty of reason, and the willingness to take any risk that reason demands of us, and they replace that with the idea that faith is a virtue. If I could change just one thing, it would be to dissociate the idea of faith from virtue, now and for good, and to expose it for what it is, a servile weakness, a refuge in cowardice, and a willingness to follow, with credulity, people who are in the highest degree unscrupulous. Thank you.
Your final question, and at the end you may summarize your arguments. What is one to make of the claim, or rather, what do you make of the claim that science and Christianity are in opposition to one another?
What am I to make of the claim that science and Christianity are in opposition to one another? I would need to hear the claim reticulated properly. To claim a point of opposition in general seems to me unhelpful. To claim points of opposition in particular seems to me rather more reasonable. In its largest aspect, Western science is, of course, an outgrowth of the Judeo-Christian tradition, especially to the extent, and perhaps only to the extent, that it is committed to the principle that the universe, the manifest universe, contains a latent structure that can be discovered by the intellect of man. I think this is true. I don't think this is very far from Gerard Manley Hopkins' declaration that the world is charged with the grandeur of God. They represent rather the same position in the world of thought. The world is charged with the grandeur of God, therefore it can be rationally comprehended. Please notice, this is very different from a Muslim claim. It's very different from the Islamic tradition in which God is assigned rather a capricious role. There is a reason that Muslim science, so fecund and glorious in the 10th, 11th, and 12th century, did come to an end unceremoniously. And it can be traced back to Muslim theological writings. So yes, I would say the Judeo-Christian tradition, the tradition of a revealed religion that is revealed in nature, but pointing to a supernatural order, has been a powerful influence on the development of Western science, one, by the way, recognized by virtually every significant scientist, every single one of them. What do I have next?
1 minute for closing remarks.
I certainly have no objection to repeating myself, but whether you're equally willing to hear myself repeated, I don't know. I've offered you three considerations. I've listened very respectfully to what Mr. Hitchens has said, and I have found myself, as he expected, immeasurably improved. However, I have heard nothing that discourages me or dissuades me from affirming the propositions that I have affirmed. The influence of atheism, even though religions have done dreadful things, has been poisonous for at least 300 years, and especially poisonous in the 20th century. Second, atheism is a position in thought, a dogmatic position in thought, an asseveration that there is no God, has had a deforming influence on the sciences because it leaves open unanswered questions that press on the human heart. And third, that atheism inevitably, in the moral sphere, leaves unanswered the question, what obliges us, what forces us, not what persuades us, what forces us to behave as we should. Thank you.
Personality, but it doesn't matter to me whether he existed or not. We have the method. He taught us how to think. If I was to tell Larry after our drive down through Shenandoah yesterday and our joint reading of the first passages of the Gospel of St. John, that the Jesus who is so real to him is in fact or could be proved to be only a fictitious person, a mythical individual, it would have to ruin Comrade Taunton's day. Not just his day, his life. It would extinguish his hope. Is there not something slightly fanatical in placing such large claims, remember the size of the claims I'm talking about,
3 minutes,
on such a slender and narrow basis? Now we'll get to the Nazis in my rebuttal, if that's all right. That won't take frightfully long, and to the totalitarians. And we'll have to do, can we be moral without believing fantastic things? That won't take too long either. And we can do a number of other things too that I have so far left unaddressed, but believe me, not forgotten. But I just wanted to see if I could introduce just for once a new element into this argument. You must, when you next go to Washington, go to the newest museum in the United States. It's the newly opened Hall of Human Origins in the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History. It's by the way, paid for by Mr. Koch, the former libertarian candidate for president and founder and paymaster of the Tea Party movement. So I invite you to join me once again in saying, in some way, this really is a great country. Here is the greatest gallery giving the proper account of evolution and our true origins that has ever been erected in any country. The bit that has fascinated me and taken me back to it again and again is this. Until 17,000 years ago only in one case, and not many more years than that in others, there were at least three other hominid or human species. Primates like us with large brain pans, language capacity, in the case of the Neanderthals, very significantly, decorated graves, which suggests, if it doesn't insist upon the idea of a ritual and a religion. They have genes in common with us. They are of our species. And they've left important traces. They weren't very well understood, or in some cases known at all, the case of the Flores Islanders of the Indonesian archipelago, only until very recently. But there they always were. They were our brothers and our sisters and our kin, and they had all these yearnings and hopes and terrors and fears. And they're not in Genesis. And they've had no one to visit their graves or do them honor until very recently, and as a result of scientific innovation and curiosity. And whatever gods they had abandoned them. And so I just think it's worth brooding, since we talk about ourselves as the objects of a tremendous cosmic and biological process that was set in motion, supervised, and if it's to be believed, designed, intended. I just think we should take a moment of silence and think of our fellow humans, our fellow creatures, our fellow extinct, already extinct members of our species, to whom we might spare a little thought before we go on. I'm in your debt, and I'll be back. Thanks.
We now move to rebuttals. 6 minutes, Dr. Berlinski.
Thank you very much. There's a disturbing area of agreement that I sense between Mr. Hitchens and myself, which I will do my best to minimize. Please remember, ladies and gentlemen, that when it comes to the wickedness of religion, I have ceded the point. It's no longer argumentative. I would remind you, however, of a remark Dr. Johnson made. He made it about original sin, and I paraphrased him. He said, "The inquiry is not necessary, for all the laws of heaven and earth are unable to prevent men from their crimes." Now, Mr. Hitchens is very much in the position of someone watching a cripple walking painfully with two crutches, moving arduously, and saying to himself and saying to you, "I've got a great idea, kick one of the crutches away. Everything will be so much better." That seems to me a weak argument. A weak argument, not an impossible argument. I would welcome the defense of the argument. But it is no rebuttal to my position that atheism poisons everything, that religion poisons something. There are plenty of poisons in the world. We don't lack an abundance. Second point I would like to mention is this strange enchantment with the views of, say, Lawrence Krauss or Stephen Hawking. You know, Stephen Hawking just published a book, and I don't know whether any of you have yet seen it. It is, again, a book explaining how everything began, why it's there, why we shouldn't worry about God, and a multitude of other subjects. He published it in collaboration with a friend of mine, Leonard Mlodinow. And, of course, the lines are very deep in the bookstores. And to paraphrase the claim that he now makes, having given up A through N, he now champions something called M theory. The claim that he now makes is the universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M theory. The universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M-theory. I don't deny what Stephen Hawking has said. I do not endorse it. I haven't read the book, although I've read his other books. I respect Hawking as a reputable physicist who did his great work 30 or 40 years ago. But I can tell you this, what is lamentably lacking in every one of these discussions is that coruscating spirit of skepticism, which a Christopher Hitchens or a Richard Dawkins or a Vic Stengel will bring to religious claims, and that lapses absurdly when it comes to scientific claims. Surely we should have the sophistication to wonder at any asseveration of the form that the universe just blasted itself into existence following the laws of M-theory, a theory that no one can understand, whose mathematical formalism hasn't been completed, and which has never once been tested in any laboratory on the face of the Earth. Third and final point of rebuttal, the fact that the Earth, our home, is a small part of the physical universe does not mean it is not the center of the universe. That is a non sequitur. After all, no one would argue, least of all Mr. Hitchens, that the doctrine that home is where the heart lies is rendered false by distance. We should be very careful about making these claims. I agree, the universe is very big, lots of galaxies, amazing things. And there is certainly some point of continuity between human beings and the animals that went before. But as for the central religious claim that this particular place is blessed and important, that's quite different. No doctrine about physical size rebuts it. Thanks very much.
How much? Yeah, I want them all. Yeah, I want them. I swore to answer Professor Berlinski's two points about totalitarianism and atheism. Well, his one point, and I had one to make, perhaps I'll make it in preface. Atheism by itself is, of course, not a moral position or a political one of any kind. It simply is the refusal to believe in a supernatural dimension or a supernatural supervisor or dictator. And it's the maintenance of the view that though that cannot be disproved, no good evidence has ever been adduced for it or any good argument put forward for it. But that's where it ends. You can be an atheist and a nihilist. You can be an atheist and a sadist. You can be an atheist and say, as is said in Dostoevsky's famous passage of Brothers Karamazov, without God, anything is possible, anything is doable, is thinkable. Of course, that's open, I would say, immediately to the objection that anyone who says they have God on their side also awards themselves, and you can see it happening by opening the newspaper, the right to commit any crime, however ghastly. That there's no escape from the existence of certain psychopathic human beings who either for want of supervision or by invoking the idea that they are the agents of a divine supervisor will do anything at all. But that gets us no further forward. You can be an atheist and a fascist. Most fascists were actually Christian. You can be an atheist and a communist. Most, but not all communists were unbelievers by definition. You can be an atheist and perfectly indifferent to your fellow creatures. But there is a humanism within atheism. It starts, I think, with Lucretius, who put the atomic theory of Democritus and Epicurus into a wonderful poem that effectively suggested not that people were using religion as a crutch, as you so in such a domesticated and furry way put it, but that instead, on a very hot day, they were putting on a huge, heavy overcoat and dragging a ball and chain. Oh dear, my crops have failed. I didn't make enough sacrifices. Oh God, I've had a filthy thought. Now I'm going to hell. Or my children are, because I didn't baptize them. Man forged manacles of terror and ignorance and stupidity, the emancipation of which, of our species, has been millimetrically slow, but in which materialist and atheist thinkers have played a great part. Without Lucretius, you only have to read Galileo's work. He's inspired by the work of Lucretius. Considers himself to be very lucky to possess one of the very few copies of Lucretius's work that was not destroyed.
For your first question, what are the weaknesses of Pascal's wager?
Well, sometimes known, by the way, as Pascal's gambit, which is, I think, a suggestive coinage. For those of you who don't know, or who might be watching and for whom this is new, I'll just state it, I hope not too crudely. Blaise Pascal, who was one of the founders of probability theory and a great mathematician and a great Catholic apologist of the 17th century, phrased it like this. He was addressing the people he called those who are so made that they cannot believe. That's me, for example. And he said, well, if you can't believe, think of it like this. If you bet that making the right adjustments to your relationship with God will save you in the future, in a future state, and you're right, you win a lot. If you're wrong, what have you lost? What have you got to lose? Now, the reason why I say wager and gambit are appropriate for this is it's obviously a very hucksterish claim, or offer, I mean to say. It's pretty cheap and pretty vulgar, and I would say especially so when offered to people who are dying or ill or frightened or in extremis. I think it's distinctly nasty and sharp practice to try it on them, but I think it's pretty sharp and nasty at any time. And you'll notice that it postulates, and here are its other weaknesses, two things. One, a very cynical and gullible God who will, if I say to him, tell you what, I'll give up the convictions of a lifetime, fling myself at your feet, pretend I believe, hope you're impressed, would say, yeah, that's good, that's progress. In other words, you get no reward for intellectual consistency, courage, honesty, anything of that sort. And of course, as with all these human-made ideas of divine tribunals, no lawyers will represent you, no appeal, and no opportunity to produce any evidence. I pass over that lightly and say, what does it ask also of the wager? It asks for someone to be a credulous, cringing, unprincipled serf who says, sure, what are principles for if not to be sold in the hope of a future boon? Well, those are the largest, I think, shortcomings of Pascalian, and by implication, all other religious reasoning about the death, judgment, and the other last things. Thank you.
Dr. Berlinski, what are the strengths of Pascal's wager?
Very good.
Hola. That from a distinguished mathematician.
They're still. Would you,
Christopher Hitchens, would you agree with the following statement made by Sam Harris? And I quote, some propositions are so dangerous that it may even be ethical to kill people for believing them.
You would be idle in dismissing it at the first reading, and obviously Sam has put it at its most blunt. But I'll give you a very practical example of a current theocratic dictatorship. We've all wondered, at least everyone of my age has since they were small, what will happen the day that a really nasty guy gets hold of a really bad weapon? That was how I thought about it when I was 7. I would now say, what happens when a messianic regime lays hold of an apocalyptic weapon? Well, we're about to find out. And the people who have plagiarized the ingredients of this weapon, stolen it from piracy on the high seas, broken every international law, every agreement, every treaty they've ever signed with the UN, the Atomic Energy Authority, EU, and so forth, are governed by the totalitarian theory called the velayat du faqih, the guardianship of the jurist, the supreme leader. Notice that again, another supreme leader, another divinely inspired dictator whose word cannot be challenged and who wants to bring on the end of days. It's not the least of my dislikes of religion that it has openly or covertly an expressed wish, a clear one, for the end of the world. It doesn't like this world, wants it to finish. People who are in the process of acquiring the secular weaponry with which to bring about genocide deserve, I think, to have their ideology treated as toxic and its characters as dangerous vermin and as, like pirates and terrorists, people who it is lawful to destroy. Yes, so to that extent, I'm with Sam, sure.
Dr. Berlinski, you're not a Christian, and indeed you're not religious, as I understand it. Why do you argue for the influence of Christianity or a Judeo-Christian influence in society?
I presume you're not asking that in the hopes of a personal declaration. I mean, I argue for a great many things, and my personal involvement in topics for debate is variable. This particular question strikes me as more important and more demanding of a personal involvement than most. I think the issue is tremendously significant. I think if we're honest about the times in which we live, it's quite right what Matthew Arnold suggested. The sea of faith has been receding under the power of a variety of forces, and the results have, in a certain way, been catastrophic for the human race. I should not say that a secular Jew has a remarkable degree of authority when it comes to discussing these events. After all, I have lived my own life under the impress of the maxim to have a good time all the time. But on the other hand, it doesn't hurt to hear these words from someone such as myself, because at least you are hearing these words for someone with no conceivable bias in their favor. I count myself as an objective observer of the circumstances. So perhaps that's the only reasonable answer I can give. These are important questions. They've had horrific consequences in human history. They continue to have horrific consequences, especially in intellectual history. And in response to why should it be that a secular Jew opens his mouth on questions pertaining to the Christian religion?
10 seconds.
It's a big tent. I'm presuming I will be welcome. Thank you.
Christopher Hitchens, what specific teachings of Jesus do you believe to be evil or poisonous?
The concept of vicarious redemption is the most repulsive, I think, and the most central. I mean, I could pick a lot of peripheral utterances of the Nazarene, or alleged utterances of the Nazarene, but the inescapable one, the one that none of his followers troubles to deny that he made, is the idea that by throwing your sins onto somebody else, onto a scapegoat, you can have them annealed, polished. That is a disgusting and immoral doctrine. If I care for you enough, I can pay your debt, even if you incurred it out of your own stupid irresponsibility. I could, if I wished, and it's been done, offer to take your place in prison, though not many people will allow the exchange, or if you were a hostage. I could do that if I loved you enough, and there are examples of people willing to put themselves forward as the substitute for someone's execution. I suppose Sidney Carton in A Tale of Two Cities is the best known folkloric one, but you cannot relieve people of their responsibility. And it's immoral to offer to do so, and it would be disgusting if it could be done. So the moral rot of Christianity is, I think, exposed in its central doctrine of vicarious forgiveness. It's an abdication of moral responsibility. I think the idea of taking no thought for the morrow, of the instructions are, abandon your family. If you don't, you are one who hates me. Give up investment, thrift, any thought of a future, children, architecture, anything of the sort. Forget all that and follow me is moral only on one condition, and it's the condition I referred to before, that the world is about to come to an end, and that only those who stick by me, a familiar trope from deluded prophets throughout the ages, are going to get out of it. Again, I would say a multiply wicked thing to be saying and offer to be making. We would be so much better off without this cult. We would think so much more clearly about the real moral questions that confront us. Thank you.
Given this choice and no other, would you prefer a secular or an Islamic Europe?
I
What, my dear sir, makes you think it's a choice right now? Large portions of Europe are already Islamic. I mean, how would I adjust the European continent? I have no opinion. Why should I judge the European continent? As far as I can tell, having conducted a relationship with the Arab community for more than 11 years, I have no objections to Muslims in Europe.
In the Christian centuries, in the hope of putting an end to such terrible, unwise speculations as that, as so much of Galileo's work was either destroyed or censored. On the slow, the thread is passed on. It's picked up by the greatest Jew who ever breathed, Baruch Spinoza, changing his name later after his excommunication from the synagogue to Benedict, who said, if there's a God, he's pantheistic, he's in nature, there's no personal God, prayers are not answered, divine interventions do not occur, the consolations of philosophy must be resorted to. From him and people like him, we get the Enlightenment, in which not only Danton and Robespierre, ladies and gentlemen, have their share, but Thomas Paine and Thomas Jefferson and the founders of this great republic and the Philadelphia Enlightenment. This is not a tradition of which anyone on my side need be ashamed. And of course, not all of it is atheist, some of it is deist, but it becomes more atheist as Darwin and Einstein and others approach us with their mind-boggling, almost one wants to say mind-altering findings. And you perhaps will say it's a coincidence that Einstein is expelled by the Third Reich, along with anyone else who understood anything about biology or physics. As practitioners of Jewish science, I'm sorry, the area of agreement has just contracted, sir. For you to say of Nazism that it was the implementation of the work of Charles Darwin is a filthy slander, undeserving of you, and an insult to this audience. Darwin's thought was not taught in Germany. Darwinism was derided in Germany, along with every other form of unbelief. All the great modern atheist thinkers, Darwin, Einstein, and Freud, were alike despised by the National Socialist regime. And there is, it said, I believe it to be true, a misprint in one German edition of The Origin of Species from which the full statement that evolution requires the survival of the fittest is taken, a statement never made by Darwin, who, as anyone knows, says that adaptability is what is likeliest to give survival or luck or advantage, we'd better say, in the struggle. Now, just to take the most notorious of the 20th century totalitarianisms, the most finished example, the most perfected one, the most ruthless and refined one, that of National Socialism, the one that fortunately allowed the escape of all these great atheist thinkers and many others to the United States, country of separation of church and state that gave them welcome. If it's a atheistic regime, then how come that in the first chapter of Mein Kampf, Hitler says he's doing God's work and executing God's will in destroying the Jewish people? How come the Führer oath that every officer of the party and the army had to take, making Hitler into a minor god, begins, I swear in the name of Almighty God, my loyalty to the Führer? How come that on the belt buckle of every Nazi soldier it says Gott mit uns, God on our side? How come that the first treaty made by the National Socialist dictatorship, the very first, is with the Vatican, exchanging political control of Germany for Catholic control of German education? How come that the churches celebrated the birthday of the Führer every day, every year, I mean, on that day, until democracy put an end to this filthy, quasi-religious, superstitious, barbarous, reactionary system? Again, this is not a difference of emphasis between us to suggest that there's something fascistic about me and my beliefs is something I won't hear said and you shouldn't believe. Thank you.
Dr. Berlinski, your recap, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you. I've endeavored to assert the following proposition. First, the general proposition that atheism poisons everything. And second, the ancillary proposition that for sure religion poisons something. These propositions are not in conflict. And at the beginning of the discussion, I said they weren't in conflict. So asseverations to the contrary introduce into this discussion neither interesting evidence nor a valid argument. In terms of the social history of atheism, it seems to me, when I began this debate, and still seems to me now, overwhelmingly clear that while Nazism in Germany, communism in Russia, communism in China even, communism in Cambodia certainly had religious elements, who would deny that? Why is that an interesting claim? The governing apparatus of ideology, no matter what Hitler had to say about his devotion to a warrior like Christ, involved the proposition among those who ruled these states and their entourage that no power was greater than their own. They acted on that proposition. They were restrained by nothing. And we saw the consequences. Now you may say, and perhaps say truly, that in their heart of hearts some Catholics adopted the rituals of the SS and took communion after an especially arduous day murdering innocent women in the fields of Poland. Could be true, I don't deny it. But what we must ask ourselves, if this is to be an intellectually serious discussion, is not whether there were infiltrations of religious thought in the worst tyrannies of mankind. Of course there were. That goes without saying. But whether something fundamental had changed in the diapason of thought that made these atrocities possible. And I say, yes, there was. I've argued as well that atheism as a position has a deforming influence on science, and I've given you my reasons. Finally, I have argued that atheism, insofar as it removes from the human context a brute sense of obligation based on fear, removes from the moral calculus profound and powerful reason not to do evil. I think there's no escaping this. It's unpleasant. I don't particularly like it. And to be perfectly honest, I haven't lived my life that way, but I recognize it as a fact. And I think we all must. With that said, I thank you for listening.
Well, I think perhaps I can help close the gap a little, the gap that Professor Berlinski complains of in my closing remarks. I came across a stray comment by George Orwell, of whom I'm a great admirer, in a little-known essay recently, in which he said, at root, all totalitarianism must be theocratic. And I thought of my most admired author, that's rather stretching it. This, it's certainly possible to identify totalitarianisms that are not explicitly religious. He went on to clarify it a bit. He said, the reason I say it's theocratic is this. In all such dictatorships, there must be certain unchallengeable assumptions, some things that are beyond discussion, that are not available for debate, that must be taken as statements of faith. In other words, in Italy, for example, under fascism, il duce ha sempre ragione. The leader is always right. The cult of the Führer. The view that Stalin could bring two or three crops a year and was the great protector of the people. The worship of Mao. Axis powers, Japan, the emperor was actually a god. Couldn't have anything more theocratic than that, though he had secular appearance as well. Now, if you think of totalitarianism in that way, and if you think of that as the greatest poison, since I'm accused not of mentioning poison enough or stressing it enough, then you'll see that the charge that is essentially theocratic is true because it depends upon unchallengeable statements, dogma, and faith. I don't know if anyone wants to name to me, or whether David will take up the challenge, a statement of atheism that is a statement purely of faith, independent of evidence, requiring no reasoning, and above all, punishable if challenged. I don't believe you can come up with anything of the sort. To the contrary, the little faction with which I'm honored to be identified as a junior member is adamant for doubt, is resolved to be skeptical. is certain only of the principle of uncertainty and says that what we have yet to know is enormously greater than anything we have discovered or known so far, and that that and only that is the test of education, of intellectual integrity, of honesty and inquiry, and, yes, let's hope for it, the emancipation of humans from man-made, and I stress man-made, delusions, including hopeful ones, including false consolation. And thus again, and I'll close by repeating myself, I've done worse, it is only those who claim to know things like the mind of God and the origins and destination and intention of the universe. It is they and only they who owe the explanation, and so far this evening haven't cared to furnish it. Thank you.
We now move to the question and answer form of time of this evening. And we begin with Christopher Hitchens. And Christopher,
in other respects, when one sees the American scientific community like a herd of wildebeests trotting across a fruited plain, it's very reasonable to ask, are they going someplace or are they fleeing from someplace? And I think the overwhelmingly obvious answer is they are fleeing. They are fleeing from an idea that they reject for a variety of reasons. Not only is the inquiry about atheism not necessary in terms of the history of social thought, it's not necessary in terms of the outlines of scientific thought, but there is a last question to be addressed, perhaps the most important for you and me. The cosmologist Joel Primack asked an interesting question. He asked, what compels the electron to follow the laws of nature? Good question, I don't know. But Heinrich Himmler, who had presided over the destruction of churches and synagogues throughout Europe and was the mastermind behind the extermination of the Jewish people, asked a very similar question in 1944. When confronted with the onerous treaty obligations the German state had adopted with respect to its own satraps, he asked insouciantly but pregnantly, after all, what compels us to keep our promises? Moral relativism is very often derided as an unhappy consequence of atheism. I don't think moral relativism is a particularly deep issue, but I do think the issue of what compels us to keep our promises is very relevant. I have in front of me rather a remarkable button. If you should press it, yours would be untold riches and whatever else you desire. The only consequence to pressing it beyond your happiness is the death of an anonymous Chinese peasant. Who among us would you trust with this button? Sit still, Christopher. Thank you.
Christopher Hitchens.
Can you give me 3 minutes, not 30 seconds? Can you give me 3 minutes, not 30 seconds? Thank you, Professor Berlinski. Thank you, Larry, for the very generous introduction. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming. At short notice, I can only hope to match the Parisian urbanity of my rival in knowledge of French ecclesiastical architecture and its cosmic implications, and in the ready access to modern 20th century poetry. Well, let's take, instead of Notre Dame and the famous story of its deconsecration by Danton and Robespierre, the erection of the other most prominent église of Paris, the one that you see on your way in from the airport, the grand wedding cake style erection of Sacré-Cœur, the Sacred Heart, built on top of the commanding heights of Montmartre. Built why? Built to celebrate the massacre of Parisian workers and intellectuals after the Paris Commune of 1871 had tried to save the honor of a humiliated France that had thrown itself officially and was thrashing at the feet of Bismarck and his Prussian invaders. Many, many more people were killed in that massacre, in that terrible reprisal, than were killed in the whole of the terror. But it was, and it wasn't enough that that was the case, but a whole church had to be consecrated by the French religious and clerical establishment and their political allies to celebrate the massacre of their fellow countrymen. Does this prove that religion poisons everything? By no means does it do so. Does it help to curtain raise and to understand the terrible century which Professor Berlinski and I have both studied? Yes, to a degree it does. This French right wing, clerical right wing, goes on to the terrible arraignment and frame-up of Captain Alfred Dreyfus, possibly the most serious miscarriage of justice in most thoroughgoingly justified and advanced by a political establishment in modern European history. This and the sides taken in it determine who will be who in the terrible war of 1914, which Dermot McCullough, admired by Larry Taunton, among others, as a historian of Christianity, and very much venerated by me in his magnificent history, new history of the first 2,000 years of Christianity, describes as a theocratic war. He says the Christendom, as we used to understand it, as our fathers and grandfathers used to understand it, ends in 1914 when every country in Europe goes to war in the name of its own God or church. King George VI is the King Emperor and the head of the Church of England. The Tsar of Russia is the head of the Russian Orthodox Church, is considered not to be a god but a little more than a human being. You know the rest of it. It's the first time that Gott mit uns is put on the belt buckles, but not the last time, of the German army. And this is the end of Christendom and the curtain raiser to fascism. Without that terrible war of Christendom, it's impossible that the totalitarian movements that became such a threat to civilization could have arisen in the first place. And just to stay with France, it is the Vichy collaborationist regime, the rounder-up of France's Jews, the massacre agent in the French colonies, the collaborator with the Third Reich, that strikes from the French coinage the noble words liberty, liberté, égalité, fraternité, and replaces them with the Catholic slogan, famille, patrie, travail. And under this, France fell to the lowest point of its history. So I would beware, sir, of deriving your argument about atheism from the coincidences of French ecclesiastical design. But I'm with you on the larger point that you made, and I'll also try and illustrate it from the work actually of a great Anglo-Catholic, Anglo-American poet, Thomas Stearns Eliot, who in his choruses from the Rock asks the question, where is the knowledge we have lost in information? This is a question that has to preoccupy us all. When I am told, and I suppose in one way you could accuse me of taking it on faith, because I couldn't prove it for myself, and having had it demonstrated to me, I probably couldn't repeat the demonstration. But having been told by Stephen Hawking and Lawrence Krauss and all of the leaders in the field of physics that we now estimate a total of 400 billion galaxies, that's not universes or solar systems, 400 billion galaxies, and asked to decide the question, with one sun every second since the Big Bang, or one star, we only call our own star the sun in an apotropaic, propitiating way that comes from our terrorized ancestors. A star that size goes out every second. So that's quite a lot while I'm talking. And has been blowing up and going out ever since the first moment of the Big Bang. This is more than we can handle. We cannot say we know about this. It can be argued that all that was indeed set in motion with the intention of producing, on a very small planet, in a very small solar system, in a tiny neglected suburb of a relatively unimportant galaxy, a race of beings, primate, but capable of language and reason, who believe that if they make the right propitiations, they will live forever. You could say that all that gigantic explosion and destruction was designed with that in mind. But I wouldn't be able to take your word for it. And it seems to me that the burden is not on me. I don't have to prove that kind of thing. I don't make the equivalent claim that the religious person has to make. The religious person doesn't have to just say, of course God wanted it that way, and that's the way it is. because a design of that kind doesn't just imply a designer, it implicates a designer. It means, if there is such a designer, he's fantastically destructive and wasteful, as he is in microcosm. 99.8% of all species ever on this earth have already become extinct. This is a pitiless, wasteful, capricious designer. I can't prove that that isn't the way he wanted it to be, but I can say that there's an implication for the designer. But again, it's not me who's saying that if you believe in it, you have the means of grace and the hope of glory and the possibility of redemption and vicarious salvation and forgiveness of sins through human sacrifice and eternal life. We can't attempt and don't try anything like that. So the agnostic or the deist is not arbitrating between equal kinds of certainty. Those who are certain in the face of all this uncertainty and unknowability, the strongest ground of agreement between me and David, are bound to say, if they're arbitrating it properly, the first people to leave the island are the ones who say they already know enough, that they know why this is happening, that they know the mind of God. Those who claim the certainty are out of the argument. The argument then goes on between deists, agnostics, and atheists. How can we make sense of what we know? And how can we, in doing so, be true to the great principle adumbrated by Socrates, which is this: you must educate yourself by striving constantly, excuse me, as hard as you can to get to the point of understanding your own ignorance. Only then can you claim to have any acquaintance with knowledge at all. That's the appropriate and due modesty that the founder of our school of thought brought to the question. And there's no proof that Socrates ever existed. I tend to think, from the eyewitness accounts and secondhand ones, that he did. It would be quite hard to confect such a...
The resolution being debated this evening is atheism poisons everything. Everything. Arguing the affirmative of the resolution is Dr. David Berlinski, a scientist, professor of mathematics, and author of many books, most notably The Devil's Delusion, Atheism and Its Scientific Pretensions. Arguing the negative of the resolution is Christopher Hitchens, a journalist, cultural critic, and best-selling author. And most recently, he is the author of the memoir, Hitch 22. We will now begin our debate. And Dr. David Berlinski, please open for us.
Thank you all very much for being here. I would like to thank Larry Taunton and the Fixed Point Foundation for their outstanding hospitality. And to Christopher Hitchens, Lanzmann, my pleasure at being allowed to bask in the radiance of his reputation, and L'chaim. The proposition before us is atheism poisons everything. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm perfectly aware, and you should be too, that that proposition is fully compatible with the proposition that religion poisons something. Were Christopher Hitchens and Richard Dawkins tomorrow to announce that they were prepared to invade hell in order to roust a variety of pederastic priests, I would wish them well, although for reasons of personal inconvenience, I could not join them. In some respects, as Dr. Johnson once said, the proposition that atheism poisons everything hardly requires a defense. The inquiry is not needed, he said. The last date at which atheism was a possibility in social thought was also the last date in which it was a plausibility in social thought. I ask you to cast your mind back, around 1790, 1791 in France, Paris, in front of the Cathedral of Notre Dame. And standing there, somewhat elaborated by my historical imagination, is Robespierre, reed thin, narrow, green-eyed, fanatical, rabid as a bat, and Danton, large, boisterous, remarkably eloquent. And they're watching, or they're looking at Notre Dame, and one guy says to the other, "What should we do with this pile of Gothic junk?" And the answer is, let's rename it. Good idea. What should we call it? Each man was hoping they would call it after themselves, but that was not to be. And Robespierre came up with a wonderful idea. We'll call it the Temple of Reason. Good thinking, his companion said. The Temple of Reason, that works splendidly. It means nothing, but it works splendidly. We might as well have called it the Temple of Evidence, Temple of Rationality. What should we do next, was the question. And the inevitable answer, the answer known from historical circumstances, well, let's go out and kill a whole lot of people. And that's exactly what they did. Once they had renamed Notre Dame the Temple of Reason, it was relatively easy to go out and kill 50,000 innocent men, women, and children. That, I submit to you, is the nature of the proposition we are discussing. 1851, 60 or 70 years later, an age of remarkable progress, enlightenment, wonderful sense of dawning material possibility, Matthew Arnold, in a poem entitled Dover Beach, reflected on the decline of religious faith in Europe, the melancholy, long withdrawing raw. He didn't see anything particularly optimistic in that withdrawal. And he could think to say to himself and to his readers, only this. Ah, my beloved, let us be true to one another. My beloved, true to one another. For the world which lies about us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath neither really joy, nor light, nor love, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help for pain, and we are caught as on a darkling plain, swept by confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night. This is a prophetic declaration from the heart of the progressive enlightened 19th century. In 1914, surveying the carnage that was to come, the Foreign Secretary of Great Britain said, again prophetically, the lights are going out all over Europe. The lights, what a strange word. We shall not see them lit again in our time. Ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that the 20th century was a record in Germany, in Russia, in China, in Cambodia, and elsewhere, not only of remarkable stupidity, brutality, and violence, but of unparalleled brutality, stupidity, and violence. And each of the regimes behind this remarkable decay of civilization had two features in common, two characteristics we should bear in mind. In the first place, the men guiding these regimes and their entourage did not believe for a moment there was any power higher than their own. And they acted on that assumption. And in the second place, in the mass murders they conducted, they were aided and supported by any number of crackpot scientific disciplines. That makes for a characteristic combination. In the case of the Nazis, the scientific disciplines were derived from biology, and especially from Darwinian biology. In 1937, having murdered 70,000 handicapped men, women, and children, the Nazis released a film, and on the background of the film, the narrator says, in terms of solemn incomprehension, "My goodness, we have sinned against the law of natural selection." The law of natural selection. What could that mean? We have sinned against the law of natural selection. The communists, of course, had an equally crackpot theory that they derived from Marxian economics, the two crackpotteries joining in one deeply repugnant stream. As all of you know, atheism today is not simply the private doctrine of a handful of individuals. It's become a social movement. And as a social movement, it has been advanced chiefly by the scientific community, certainly in the United States, but to a large extent in Europe, too. Some of this is adventitious. A few popular writers, such as Richard Dawkins, discovered that by writing books indicating that science has shown that God does not exist, well, they could make a fortune. I'm very sorry I wasn't there to join them. I didn't think of it at the time. I'm quite sure that someone now is writing a book, How Margarine Science Shows That God Does Not Exist. But the inevitable consequences of this degree of atheism within the scientific community has involved a deformation of scientific thought, quite striking in its character and its extent. After all, the sciences, if we restrict our attention to the serious sciences, and those may be found in mathematics or in mathematical physics in no other place, then we must recognize that the serious sciences have nothing to say about the existence of God, either in their premises or in their conclusion. What a remarkable fact. People are writing books how physics shows that God does not exist, but physics has nothing to say about the existence of God. The aching questions that trouble the human imagination, about which the sciences, when seriously considered, are resolutely silent, these remain just where they were. And the religious tradition, especially the Judeo-Christian religious tradition, has offered a coherent body of belief and doctrine by which they can be explained. Do we understand why the universe arose 14 million? No, we don't. Do we understand why it's there at all? No, we have no idea. Do we understand how life emerged on Earth? Not a prayer right now. Do we understand the complexity of life? We can't even begin to describe a living creature in anything resembling precise terms. Recent article in Science Digest, cell division requires 4,000 coordinated proteins acting together. What a remarkable statement. What a wealth of information we possess about biology. What an abundant lack of understanding we have about living systems. Do we understand why the laws of nature are true? No, we have no idea. Do we understand the miracle of analytic continuation in physics when certain kinds of functions can be pushed forward into the future contrary to all experience? Do we understand why the universe remains stable from moment to moment? The medievals pondered this question, ladies and gentlemen, and they came to the conclusion, and I quote a medieval theologian, that God is everywhere conserving the world. What a remarkable declaration. Can we do without it? Can we do without it? Do we have an explanation for the continuity and stability of the universe? There is one paper that I know in the literature by Freeman Dyson that addresses the stability of matter. But beyond that, everything is enigmatic. How can we propose seriously and solemnly to rule out of court in advance a hypothesis that not only answers to the human heart in many respects, but that answers to genuine intellectual needs?